Well, I'm just gonna say it. Cloth? It's pretty tough. Yes, there's some cloth that's soft, but that's not what I meant. Simulating CG cloth and fabrics can be an arduous process beyond simply just dropping it onto a table. And don't even get me started on trying to recreate folds, alright? It doesn't have to be this way though. In this video, we are going to explore three easy features that can make the cloth simulation pipeline bend and fold to your every whim with great ease. I'm Chunk Trafficander with CG Cookie. Let's get into it. Alright, and so I'm here in a new Blender scene, and the first thing I want to do is I'm going to go ahead and add a plane, right? Because this is going to be our cloth mesh right here. And to start that off, we're going to need to add a little bit more faces to this guy, because if we go into edit mode, you can see that with one face, we're not going to really be able to get the most awe-inspiring cloth simulation. So I'm going to go ahead and quickly subdivide this guy. And I'm going to come down to this operator panel. And I'm going to go ahead and actually just give it 40 cuts. So that way you can see that we've got a lot of faces to work with, but it's still small enough that it's not going to blow my computer up while I'm also trying to record this. So we've got this guy all set up here. And now I want to go ahead and I'm going to go into our physics properties. And over here, I'm going to select cloth. And you can see that now if I hit spacebar on my keyboard or come down to my little timeline here and hit play, you can see that we're going to have our plane just kind of fall into oblivion. And that's pretty sweet. That means that our cloth physics are working, but we're going to have to actually constrain some of these vertices or pin our vertices so that we're going to be able to work with our plane so that it's not just constantly falling into the never-ending abyss of the 3D viewport. So I'll come back into edit mode for this guy, and I'm going to want to pin it on this end and this end over here. And so if I come into the vertex properties, you can see that we have a vertex groups section. And so I've got these guys selected here. I'm going to hit plus just to create a new group, and I'll go ahead and just call this group pin. And now with my vertices selected, I'm going to go and hit assign. So I'll just deselect those. And if I have this group selected and hit select, you can see that it's going to select everything in the group. So that's pretty sweet. And I'll come back down to the physics. And under our cloth, I'm going to go to where it says shape. And you can see that we're going to have this pin group, and it's going to accept vertex groups as our objects here. So I'll select that guy. We only have one vertex group, which is going to be pin, and that's awesome. So now what I can do, if I hit play on my keyboard, you can see that where we've pinned these vertices, it's going to basically not allow it to move, but the rest of the vertices on our mesh are going to be able to freely move. So that's going to be pretty handy. We can also come in up top here and play around with, if we click on this guy here, some presets, right? So if we go to maybe something like rubber, you can see that it's going to really bounce around a little bit more. And we're going to get a whole bunch of different property setups basically from using these. So depending on the kind of fabric that you're going to be wanting to work with, these might give you a good starting point to kind of get the effect that you're looking for. I'm going to go back to cotton. So now if I go ahead and hit the play button and I try and scale this guy down on the X, say, you can see that it's not really getting the effect that I want. And we're going to have a lot of trouble, and you can see that we're going to get a lot of kind of visual glitches as stuff starts shooting around and physics start going haywire. And so in order to get these ripples and some of these folds in the cloth, we're going to have to figure out a different way that we can scale our object down without actually scaling the object itself. And so this is where the idea of object constraints comes in. And so if I come down here, you can see that there's this little kind of gear looking thing. And if I come into here, you can see that we're going to get a lot of different useful resources that you've probably not used or even really seen before, because it's kind of a scary area of Blender, right? Like what is a camera solver? What is a damped track? It's a lot of big, scary words that really are kind of vague if you've not been around them for any extended period of time. But the constraint that I'm going to use for this guy is under transform and copy scale. And what this is going to allow us to do is I'm going to be able to create kind of like a parent controller. And when I go ahead and scale that guy up or down, we're going to be able to pretty much copy the scaling factor of that parent object to be used to scale this guy up or down as well. And you can see that's exactly what it's going to do because we have this target, but we don't have anything else in our scene to actually be used as this controller. So the first thing I'm going to do with that is I'm going to go ahead and add a new plane. And I'm just going to get rid of these vertices here. And I'm going to move this vertice back into the center here. So that I'm just going to have this edge, right? We're just going to have two vertices, and in between it, it's going to be an edge. And the reason I like this guy is because I like to scale it up and down like this, and it's going to give me a very clear indication as to what the scaling of my edges is going to be like, right? Because it's pretty much the same length. Well, not pretty much. It is the same length as these edges here. So it's a pretty good representation of how it's going to scale down. So I'm going to select our cloth again. And I'm going to go ahead and just add this guy as our target. So now you can see just straight out of the box here, if I scale this guy down, it's going to scale down our plane here. So in a nutshell, that's pretty much all it is. But if we take a look at the constraint modifier here, you can see that we're going to get a bunch of different options here. And so the first ones I want to focus on is this X, Y, and Z, right? And that should be pretty obvious as to what it is, right? It's going to copy the target's X, Y, and Z scale. So if I just uncheck these two here, and I go ahead and scale this guy down now, you can see that it's only going to affect the X scale. And same thing for the Y, if we go ahead and scale this guy down. Again, I'm not constraining it to any axis. I'm just scaling it down on all three, as you can see kind of up in the top left corner here. But it's only going to scale our child object down on the specified axis. We can also do more than one at a time, right? I wanted to scale it down both on the X and the Y. And in this tutorial, I'm just going to make sure to scale it down on the X for now, because I only want to crunch it or scrunch it inwards on the X, but I don't really want to make the whole object smaller as a whole. And finally, the last thing that I want to do is I want to come down to space. And you can see that right now the space that the target, this guy here, is being evaluated in is in world space. And I'm going to go ahead and just change that to local. And I'm also going to change the space that this guy is being evaluated in into local as well. And all that's really going to allow you to do is if you come up here and you start moving this guy around and rotating it on pretty much any axis or direction that you want, when you start to scale it down, it's still going to work pretty much as it does right here, right? Where I'll scale it down and it will scale in on the X of this guy here. That's pretty much just the general idea of it. So now that I've got that, I'm going to hit space on my keyboard to play this guy, and I'm going to scale this guy down. And you can see that immediately, right, we're going to get all of these kind of folds and these creases here. And that's going to be really cool because that's a super effective way of going about creating cloth. But you can see that after a certain amount of time, my cloth kind of went flat again. It's like it restarted. And that's pretty much exactly what it did. If I bring this guy up here, right, and we go ahead and play this, and I'm going to scale this down just a little bit there, you can see that as it works towards the end of 250 frames here, it's going to start the whole simulation over. So what I'm going to do is just bring our end up to be something like 1,000, so that way we're going to be able to get something that we're pretty satisfied with without having to worry about our whole simulation starting over on us. So that's pretty sweet. I'll bring that right back down, and I'm just going to clear the scale again with Alt S. So how else can we use this, right? Because we've kind of developed a bit of a workflow here for creating some creased or folded cloth. But what's kind of the use case for that? Well, I'm going to take this guy I'm just going to duplicate them, rotate it on the X 90 degrees, and in edit mode, I'm going to just bring them up one. So this guy is going to act like a drape, right? Hanging vertically. And this could be a more prominent reason why you'd want to use this kind of workflow. I'm going to make sure to get rid of this bottom row of vertices here from our vertex group. So I'll just go ahead and remove it. So that now it's only going to dangle from the top there. So if I go ahead and just hide this guy, I maybe got to change this to be something like, we'll go to denim up here. And if I hit play and scale this down, right? You can see that very easily and quickly, we're going to be able to get some pretty cool looking hanging drapes. And if I shade that smooth, right? Immediately, we're going to be able to get really nice creases and really great control over our fabric. And it's going to allow us to do some pretty crazy stuff. By working with cloth using a combination of pin groups, copy scale constraints, and preset fabric physics, we are going to be able to get a wide variety of results that we can use to capture cloth in pretty much any capacity. Most of the fun comes from experimenting with these different combinations to create realistic, interesting, and sometimes goofy results. Thank you for watching this CG cookie tutorial, and happy blending.